Romans chapter 8. We'll begin reading verse 26 in Romans chapter 8. Very familiar portion of Scripture. It says, "Likewise the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities, for we know what we should pray for as we ought. But the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. And he that searcheth the heart knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the saints according to the will of God. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called, are the called according to his purpose. For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he also called, and whom he called, them he also justified, and whom he justified, them he also glorified. What shall we then say to these things?" Boy, I love this. "If God be for us, who can be against us?" Amen? Isn't that good? Oh, I'll tell you, that's good. Good scripture. "He that spared not his own Son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God that justifieth. Who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died, and yea, rather that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord." Man, good scripture. Oh, boy, that's good. That's good. Man, I tell you what, we could spend the night here just preaching on a few of those verses. Amen. I know somebody said, "Oh, please don't, preacher," but that's okay. Look with me in verse 37. "Nay, in all these things," everything you've been talking about here, "we're more than conquerors through him that loved us." I'd like to preach a message that I've titled, "Don't Embrace Small Christianity." Let's pray. Father, we come to you asking, Lord, that you'd help us to realize what we have in Jesus Christ, who we have in Jesus Christ. And Lord, what you're wanting to do in our hearts and lives. Lord, you said that you wanted to make us in the image of your Son. Lord, we are your workmanship. Now to have your will and way, Lord, in our hearts and lives tonight, Lord, stir our hearts to realize how great and mighty our God is. May you be glorified, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You be seated. Much of what we see and encounter in the world today is what I would call small Christianity. Not much to it. Pretty meager, and it seems like Christians don't seem to want much more. You know, they just want that little cabin over in Glory Land, amen? And I want more than a little cabin over in Glory Land. I want that precious promise of that mansion that's going to be built upon the side of the Father's house, amen? I don't want to be sitting off over there in the corner. I want to be in the presence of God all the time throughout all eternity. So many times it's our little walk with the Lord. It's our little in our knowledge of the Bible, little in our prayer lives, not spending much time in praying with our whole hearts, little in our separation, being more like the world than like God, little in our witness, talking about everything but the greatest thing, Jesus Christ. Little in our faithfulness. We're faithful to self. We're faithful to the world. We're faithful to everything, but little faithfulness to the Lord himself. Little in our faith. We can trust everything else, but it seems like when it comes down to trusting God, we have so little faith. Little in our service. We can serve everything else, and we can do this and we can do that, but our service is so small and little unto the Lord. Worship. We can go to the ball games and we can scream and holler and shout for the ball teams, and we can cheer on everybody else. But boy, when it comes to worshiping God, so little in our worship to the Lord. So very little we embrace such a small Christianity. On goes the list of how small our Christianity is today in the world. We literally make our God a little God in the eyes of the lost world. Too often I think that the world, they look at you and me and they see how we live our lives, and they don't see the great God that we have. They don't see His greatness. They don't see His abundance. They don't see His magnificence. They don't see His power and His ability in our lives, because we make so little of the things of God, and make so little of the Word of God, and make so little of our God in our lives on a daily basis, when He should be the exalted thing and the exalted one above all things, and magnified in a great way. Hey, listen, He ought to be exalted in a powerful way.
Amen.
We have and serve a mighty God. Nay, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through Him that loved us. We find over in Zephaniah 13, or chapter 3, and verse 17, says, "The Lord thy God in the midst of thee is mighty." He's mighty. He will save. He will rejoice over thee with joy. He will rest. He will rest in His love. He will joy over thee with singing. He's a mighty God. And I think so often, far too often, our God is too small in our minds, and too small in our thinking, too small in our talk, too small in our actions, too small in everything around us. And because you don't see Him with the eye, many times you make too little of Him. Yet He's an all-knowing God. He knows what you're thinking right now. He knows what your mind is on right now. He knows what's going through your mind, and He knows what's going through your thoughts about tomorrow and the week that's ahead of you. He's an all-powerful God. There's no one that, or anything, as powerful as He is. And yet many times we don't realize that He is willing to use that power to help us and to direct us and to guide us and to meet the needs that we have. He's an all-powerful God. There's no one or anything that is as powerful as He is. He's an ever-present God. Omnipresent, the Bible speaks of. And yet many times we fail to even stop and give Him a thought. And I don't think you'll mind me sharing this. I like what Brother Dale said. He said the other day, he pulled up here with this more. And thank you, Brother Dale, for clearing that fence line out and doing all that. Man, it looks good. Appreciate that. He pulled in there with the mower on the back of his tractor, and he went up and took a piece of wire off, come back, and he looked back there, and part of the mower had fell off. But he drove it all the way over here, but it fell off right there. He said the first thought he had was, praise the Lord. If that had fell out off, you know how people tailgate you on the streets and the highway and everything? If that fell off, they'd have had a piece of that chunk of steel right in the front of their vehicle. And he had been responsible for it. Praise the Lord. You know, that's the way it ought to be in our lives. That we're willing and able to give God thanks and praise, I mean, over all things. You say, well, preacher, just a piece that fell off of there. Yeah, but it could have been a disaster. It could have been really something bad. The thing of it is, many times we, oh, boy, I'm glad that didn't happen over there. You know, boy, it could have happened. And we didn't give God the praise and honor and glory for it. I can just imagine with Dale driving and swinging that thing back and forth and on the streets and running up on the curbs and around everything else like he normally does, and around the trees to get over here and everything. If that angel was on there, I'll be glad when he gets stopped so I can take my hand off this thing. Amen. But that's our God. Yeah. Something that seems so small, He does in a great way. That could have fell off anywhere, but it waited until He got over here and it dropped off. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
He's a mighty God. And we need to understand that we're more than conquerors, the Scripture says, through Him. Much of what is done in the church today and done in our lives is done in the power of our flesh. What we can do. We have a God that wants us to go beyond what we can do and let Him do what He can do in so many areas of our life. You know, I think people have had this idea, and there's things that He wants us to do. I don't think we're just supposed to sit back and do nothing. I believe that He wants to empower us to do what He wants done. He gives us the strength and ability, but it's for us to rely upon Him and to serve Him in a way that He can empower us to do great and mighty things for His name's sake. You see, we've limited the Lord by our unbelief. just as even did the children of Israel. The psalmist said in Psalm 78, verse 19, yea, they spake against God. They said, can God furnish a table in the wilderness? Now, wait a minute. God had been feeding them the whole time that they come out of Egypt and feeding them with the manna from heaven and quail and everything. And they said, can God furnish a table in the wilderness? And sometimes if we're not careful, we get the same way. You think God can? Well, He can, but I don't know if He will. We begin to question God and what He's able to do by our unbelief. Yea, chapter 78, verse 4, 1 says, they turned back and tempted God and limited the Holy One of Israel. Can I tell you something tonight? If you don't get anything else the rest of the night, I want you to zero in on this for me, okay? They limited God. Why? Because He wasn't a big God in their eyes. Though He had used the plagues to bring them out of Egypt, though He had parted the Red Sea, though He had shown His hand mighty and closed the Red Sea up on Pharaoh's army, though He had taken care of them and met every need they had, they limited God and say, yea, can God? You and I, if we're not careful, we limit God in what He can and wants to do in our lives. So many times we make Him such a small God. Even Jesus, when He went to His own hometown area there, and He was limited by unbelief. In Matthew 13, 58 says that He did not many works there because of their unbelief. And what was it? It was that their mindset was that He wasn't really God. Their mindset is that He wasn't a big God. It's not so much that we don't believe as it is that our faith is small and so we don't act upon it. Why? Because everything is small in our eyes. We're not fully persuaded enough to boldly trust and follow the Lord. Romans 8 there in verse 38 says, for I am persuaded. Can I ask you tonight, what are you persuaded about God? Well, preacher, I'm persuaded that He saved my soul. I'm saved. Okay, but what else are you persuaded about God? Paul said, hey, I'm persuaded. And he goes on and talks about what he's persuaded about, but what are you persuaded about God? If we went around the room and say, what has God persuaded you about Him? What would you say? What are you persuaded with? When I see guys that walk in and they got big old muscles on them like that, and there's a pair, a set of weights there, and a barbell, and it's got a whole bunch of weights on it. And I look at the muscles on their shoulders and on their arms and their legs and everything. You know what? I'm pretty well persuaded they're going to be able to pick that thing up. But when I look at God, what am I persuaded about Him about? That He can do great and mighty things. That He will do great and mighty things. Or am I persuaded that He's, yeah, He could, but He won't. And He becomes a small God in my heart and mind. Paul said there, he said, for I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angel, nor principality, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor depth, or nor height, nor depth, or any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. He's talking about an almighty God who created all things. Christians, we need to get persuaded of the mighty God we serve, and that He wants us to step out by faith and come alive for Him in these last days. Are you persuaded that you can tell people about Jesus Christ? Are you persuaded that He'll be there with you when you talk to Him about Jesus Christ? Are you persuaded that He'll save lost souls? Are you persuaded that He'll forgive you your sins? Are you persuaded that He's there at all times? Are you persuaded the Bible is true from cover to cover? Are you persuaded? Are you persuaded? Are you persuaded?
Amen.
Well, I'll tell you what, there ought to be a moving in our hearts and lives that we would be persuaded. I'm persuaded my nose keeps running, I'll tell you that right now. Persuaded. Christians are fainting. They're falling away. In a time when we ought to be drawing closer to the Lord. In a time when we ought to be walking in victory, we're wallowing in defeat. You know, as we see all the wickedness going on, it ought to embolden us, knowing that our God is able to handle it all, that we can live for Him. And you know what we do? We many times we crawl back into it. Have you ever watched those little hermit crabs? They'll go find a little shell, and they'll crawl inside that little shell. As they grow, they have to abandon that shell. They go find another one, and they get a little bigger, and they get a bigger shell, and they crawl inside that one. And when they get a little bit bigger, they have to get out of that one, go find another shell, and crawl inside of it. Do you know what our problem is? As Christians, we keep crawling inside another shell. It's time that we quit crawling in shells and start standing up for the Lord Jesus Christ and magnifying Him, that others can see how great and mighty and big our God is.
Amen.
And taking a stand for His glory, and taking a stand for righteousness and godliness in this day and time. Proverbs 24:10 says, If thou faint in the day of adversity, thy strength, and listen, is small. There's some rough days ahead. You can crawl inside a shell, or you can stand with the Lord Jesus Christ. And we need to be strong, and we need to have a great God, and knowing that He will do great and mighty things. Too many Christians are half in and half out. They're not persuaded. They're half in serving God and half out not serving God.
Yeah.
Well, we need to give up our little Christianity and take up a great Christian life in Christ. You know, if you look at your Christian life, can I ask you something? I know this is real personal, but I think we got to get personal sometimes. What is your Christian life doing for somebody else? What is your Christian life? Not mine, not as a preacher, but what is your Christian life? 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 We go all the way around the room and point the finger. And really, each of us ought to take the finger and point at ourselves and say, what is my Christian life doing for the life of others? What kind of impact is it making? Do they see something great? Do they see something that they desire? Do they see something that is impacting them in a powerful way? Or is my Christian life so small that it makes no effect in their life? Oh, how we need to have put away that little Christianity and take on that greatness of God in our lives. 2 Peter 3:11 says, seeing then that all these things shall be dissolved, what manner of person ought ye to be in all holy conversation and godliness? He said, what kind of person? He said, what kind of person should you be? What type of Christian should you be? Should you be one of those little bitty small Christians that people step on like a bug? Or people can't see? Oh, I'll tell you what there ought to be. Our Christianity ought to. Have you ever maybe go someplace to a ball game or to maybe a play, a thespian hall or something like that, to watch a play, and you sit down there and there's people in front of you and then you got this great view in front of you, and then somebody comes and sits down in front of you, and you're like, I can't see anything. You can't. All you see is the back of their head. And it's some big old guy he's got so many rolls in the back of his head, he looks like a pack of hot dogs back there. And you can't see around him. And so you switch seats with somebody. And then his brother comes down and sits in front of you again over on that side. And you're almost, well, I can't see. All I can see is them. Can I tell you something? Our Christianity ought to be so big that all they can see is Jesus Christ in your life and in my life.
Amen.
They can't see all this world and wickedness, and they can't see us, but they see Jesus Christ. That's the type of life that we ought to have. It's about time that Christians wake up and quit playing games and making excuses. Start living with victory and living in the power of the Lord and serve with a mighty God, realizing that how mighty and great He is. Every promise in this book is ours. But we've got to give up our little Christianity to get it. You hear me? Every promise in that book is yours. But if your Christianity is small, you'll never be able to claim it. But it requires you to realize how great your God is. We need to give up, first of all, our little prayers. Too many times it says, "Now I lay me down to sleep" stuff. Some memorized prayer. Oh, how we need to begin to pray and talk to the Lord from our heart. Walk with Him in prayer and seek His face. You hear me quoted often in Jeremiah 33:3 says, "Call unto me, and I will answer thee and show thee itty bitty things." Doesn't say that, does it? It says, "Call on me, and I will answer thee and show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not." I'm telling you what, prayer has a great power to do great and mighty things in the hearts and lives of people around you and in your own life. For the most part, our prayer lives are very anemic. We need to get back to that fervent prayer in our day and time. In James chapter 4, verses 2 through 3, it says, "And ye lust and have not, ye kill and desire to have, and ye cannot obtain, ye fight in war, yet ye have not because ye ask not." We're not asking God. Goes on and says, "Ye ask and receive not, because ye ask amiss, that ye may consume it upon your lust." He said, "You're praying for the wrong reason." He said, "Your prayers are so small, and it ought to be a prayer that reaches way beyond you and reaches beyond the things around you." We get pretty fervent about other things in our lives, but what about our prayer? A prayer that has a hot heart after God. We read on over in James chapter 5 there, it says, "Confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that you may be healed." And then he says this, "The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much." Do you know what that is? That's serious prayer. That's big prayer. That's asking for things that people don't even think about asking for. That's a prayer that's on fire for God and wanting to take a hold of God and not turn loose until God answers and see God do great and mighty things again. We need Christians who are going to pray fervently for lost souls to be saved. Pray fervently for Christians to come back to God. Pray fervently for this nation. Pray fervently for the church. Pray fervently for one another. Pray fervently for God to be lifted up and magnified in our area that He might be glorified in a great way. Fervent prayer on fire for God. Not these little bitty prayers, "Lord, thank you for the day. Amen." Fervent prayer. Fervent prayer. Prayer with power and might in and through the Holy Spirit. In Romans 8 there, verse 26, it says, "Likewise the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities, for we know not what we should pray for as we ought. But the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings that which cannot be uttered. And he that searcheth the hearts knoweth what is the mind of Christ, of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the saints according to the will of God." And so we have the one that dwells with you. You say, "Well, preacher, how can my prayer get more fervent? How can my prayer have more power?" And my friend, if you begin to pray and allow the Holy Spirit to guide you as you pray and seek His leadership and seek His wisdom as you pray and ask Him how you ought to pray, God will allow the Holy Spirit to pray in your stead. We need to give up our little prayer life. Take on a mighty prayer life. We need to give up our little weak faith and trade it for a great faith. Hebrews 11:16 says, "But without faith it's impossible to please Him. For he that cometh to God must believe that He is, and that He's a rewarder of them that diligently seek Him." You know, a lot of times we quote that first part, "But without faith it's impossible to please God, please Him." But listen, let me read the last part of it again. "For he that cometh to God," that's coming in prayer, "must believe that He is," He is what? That He's God. Amen. That He's God. And that He's a rewarder. He's able to do something of them that diligently seek Him. Faith. Faith believing that God can do great and mighty things. so much faith believing that we're willing to step out and do what he wants us to do. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5, you hear me quote all the time. I consider 5 through 7 my last verse. It says, trust in the Lord. What did he say again? Say it with me. Trust in the Lord. Then he says, with all thine heart. Say that with me. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart. Many times it's not with all of our heart, is it? We're not trusting with all of our heart. But we go on to the other part and it says, and lean not into thine own understanding. Many times we're leaning on our own understanding instead of trusting him. We need to trust in the Lord with all of our heart. The parable of the mustard seed puts us to shame. In Matthew 17, 20, Jesus said unto them, because of your unbelief, because it's so small, your belief is so small. For verily I say unto you, if ye have faith as a grain of a mustard seed, ye shall say unto this mountain, remove hence to yonder place, and it shall remove, and nothing shall be impossible unto you. Do you know what our problem is? We waver back and forth. Will he? I don't know. Can he? Yeah. But will he? I don't know. And our faith is weak. Our faith is small. We waver back and forth. Jude 1:20 says, But ye, beloved, building up yourselves on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. It's not just a faith that's built up on you. It says a most holy faith. Otherwise, that faith is placed upon someone else, the Holy Spirit of God that dwells within you, not on self, not in your abilities, not in what you're able to do, but what God can do. As we trust him and our faith, we want our faith to grow. But my friend, listen, what good is faith if you don't ever use it? Yeah. How will it ever grow if you never stretch it and exercise it? Oh, how we need to begin to have faith and trust what God says that he can and will do in our lives. Build up that faith. Don't allow it to remain small. Trust the Lord and obey his word. We need to give up our little prayer life. We need to give up our little faith, weak faith. We need to give up a little life of, or that little life of worship, and trade it for a life of great worship. Get to know the Lord and lift him up. Count your blessings and lift him up, and recount your salvation and lift him up, and look at his mighty works and lift him up. Oh, how we need to, you know, sometimes our worship is nothing more than, oh, thank you, Lord. Well, that's better than nothing, but my friend, that's awful small. When there ought to be within us a swelling up of gratitude and thanksgiving and love for him and magnify him and praise him and worship him and lift him up, not just in silent, but in front of others and sharing him with others, because you're so happy and excited about who he is and what he's doing in your life that you worship him and lift him up. The psalmist said in Psalms 29:2, give unto the Lord the glory due unto his name. Do you ever stop and think about how much he deserves our worship? It says, glory due unto his name. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. We need to give up our little prayer life. We need to give up our little faith. And we need to give up our little worship. And we need to give up our little stroll now and then with the Lord and take up a daily walk with God. Amen. Too many times our stroll is just on Sunday. Our walk with God is just when difficulty comes and we got to find him because of problems. Our walk with God is just when things are going good, maybe through at work, and you just thank him a little bit and you walk with him a little bit. But my friend, we need to give up that little walk and take up a daily walk with him. Yes. Philippians 3:10 says that I may know him. You can't know him with just a little walk. There's been those times that I've met people, you've met people, you know, it's just one of those quick little deals there, and you introduce yourself, they introduce themselves, you meet them, you shake their hand maybe, and you talk just for a couple of minutes, and then you're gone. Kind of like those times when I'd be on an elevator and somebody comes in, and I'll ask them, you got family here? And many times I try to open up before I give them a gospel tract. You got family here? You got somebody in the hospital? What's wrong with them? And they'll tell me, and I'll reach in and pull out a gospel tract, give to them, and I may never see that person again. And so I may never know them or even what takes place in their life. Just a little introduction. But so sadly, that's the way we are many times with Jesus Christ daily. Just a little in and out when we ought to walk with Him and fellowship with Him and allow Him to be a part of everything in our lives continually, daily. We need to give up that little stroll and take a daily walk with Him, knowing Him. Then we need to give up your little hit and miss service and faithfulness. Chapter 12 and verse 30 says, "And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thine heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind, and with all thy strength." This is the first commandment. It's really putting something into your Christian life. That's living for Him with an excitement. That's making something out of Him by your faithfulness in serving Him and living for Him. We need to give up our little Christianity. Amen. We need to set it aside. Realize how big our God is. Realize how powerful He is. Realize how wonderful He is. How loving He is. And make much of Him. Make much of Him. All tomorrow, you may be in the presence of somebody talking with them. It's an opportunity for you to make much of God. Preacher, I just don't know how to get into that conversation. It's not hard. What do you mean? Oh, did you see that rain we got yesterday? Yeah, boy, that was good. We need that, didn't we? Yeah, God knows just what we need. God sure is good. He blessed us with that rain. Well, God's been good to me. I just want to thank Him. You have a flat tire. Somebody stops. You don't have a spare. Or you pull out the spare and it's as bad as the one that's on there. And they help you. I want to thank you for coming. Stopping. I know it was God that put it in your heart to stop. Huh? Oh yeah, my God's great. He does that. He knows the need and He meets the need. Because I'm a child of God, He's so good to me. Preacher, you think that we ought to maybe quit thinking God's so small? I think so. Do you think it'd be all right if we begin to brag on Him? I think He wouldn't mind a bit. You think that He'd care if we'd tell others about Him? I think He'd be glad. Do you think that He'd care and mind it? Do you think He's got time for me if I would spend some more time with Him, walking with Him this week? I know He would. He's waiting for you to make time for Him. Put away your little Christianity, because we serve a great God and a mighty God. Let's bow. Father, we thank You. We love You. Help us to determine in our hearts and lives, Lord, to not just have a little prayer life, but one that sees great and mighty things happen. Help us, Lord, determine our hearts and lives not to just take a little stroll with You, but to walk with You daily. Lord, help us determine our lives not to have a little faith, but have great faith. Lord, help us to not just worship You a little, but worship You in a great way. Help us to lay aside this little Christianity for the greatness that You made it to be, because we're more than conquerors through Jesus Christ. Have Your own way, Lord, in our lives. May You be glorified. This we ask and pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand with your heads bowed, your eyes closed?